So having completed the function of the vestibular system, today we'll begin the chapter on posture and equilibrium, how it is maintained. Because we have already learned how the vestibular apparatus helps in maintaining the equilibrium, not only in a static position as well as in motion. So today's chapter is on posture and equilibrium. How the posture is being maintained. So, what is posture? It is actually the resistance of the body against gravity and acceleratory forces so that the body is prevented from displacement or any disequilibrium. So, it is actually the resistance which is very active done by the body to prevent disequilibrium or any displacement. So, what is the force acting against? It will be either gravity or any acceleratory force. So, if there is any acceleratory force, what happens is the body will not be stabilized. It can move. The body has to maintain its position in the space. That is also necessary. Now, what is the importance of having this posture? So, the person can maintain the posture against gravity when he is sitting, standing, or whatever posture he is adopting while not doing any activity. At the same time, if he is doing some voluntary activity, there should be a stable postural background on which the person can do the work, the voluntary activity. For example, a person is sitting and writing or doing a typewriting. Suppose the person is doing some voluntary activity which needs a rhythmic moving, like digging, doing some labor work, then the body is, as a whole, is moving. At the same time, the body has to maintain the equilibrium also. So, irrespective of the person doing a voluntary activity or otherwise, the person has to maintain the posture. So, that is actually being done by a group of muscles which are called as the anti-gravity muscles, and in human beings, it is the flexors of the upper limb and the extensors of the lower limb which are acting mainly as the anti-gravity muscles. So, when we consider the human being, a two-legged animal, the normal posture is standing upright. In that position, it is the flexors of the upper limb and the extensors of the lower limb acting as the anti-gravity muscles. But there are other group of muscles also which help us to maintain the posture. That includes the muscles or the retractors of the neck. Then we have the muscles on the back. So, this muscle mainly can be called as the erector capitis of the neck. Then we have the erector spinae muscles of the back. Then coming down to the hip, we have the gluteus muscle. Coming again down in the knee, we have the quadriceps muscle. And when we reach the ankle joint, there are two group of muscles. One is a plantar flexors, other is a dorsiflexors. Both of them should not contract. So, the ankle joint is kept against gravity in such a way that it is intermediate in a position between the contraction of the plantar flexors and the dorsiflexors. So, all these muscles will help a man or a human being to stand erect. These are the anti-gravity muscles. Because if we consider the plantar flexors, and the dorsiflexors of the knee joint, when it produces alternate movements or contraction of these muscles, it results in walking. So, both of them help in walking, which is a locomotion. But this maintenance of the posture at the level of the ankle joint is happening because of the intermediate position of the joint between the contraction of either the plantar flexors and the, or both of them are not completely contracting. So, this is how the posture, which is erect in a human being, is maintained by this group of anti-gravity muscles. So, these anti-gravity muscles should remain contracted for long when a person maintains the same posture for a long while. And these muscles should never be fatigued also. And the energy expenditure should also be less. So, the anti-gravity muscles have to remain contracted for a while, for a long time, whatever be the person maintains that posture, it should not get fatigued. At the same time, the energy expenditure should also be less. So, we already have learned in the skeletal muscle fibers, we have two types of skeletal muscle fibers. One is a red muscle fiber and the other one is a white muscle fiber. So, we know the red does not get fatigued fast, whereas the white gets fatigued fast. So, there are the group of fibers with variable proportion that is present in the skeletal muscles, the variable muscles. But always, the red muscles will be more in the group of the anti-gravity muscles that help in the maintenance of the posture. And during contraction, he said that all the muscle fibers will not contract simultaneously. It contracts in relay, so that at the time only a percentage of the fibers will be in the contracted state. So this also is a protective phenomena whereby the muscle will not be fatigued earlier. And red muscle fibers are mainly present for the posture maintaining muscles or the anti-gravity muscles. So now this is regarding the posture. Now coming to the movement or locomotion, whatever it is, or any voluntary activity, movement or activity which is voluntary. So when it comes to this type of movement or the activity, the motor system is itself of a three-tier system, where we have the cerebral cortex first at the highest level, then we have the subcortical structures, as we have already learnt about the cerebellum and the basal ganglia, and then we have the third level of the brain stem and the spinal cord. Why brain stem? Because we know the motor nuclei is the alpha motor neuron that is present in the spinal cord, and we have the alpha motor neuron of the cranial nerves which is present in the brain stem. So these are all forming the final common pathway for any voluntary activity, because alpha motor neuron is the final common pathway. So we have the three-tier system for the motor system itself, where the cerebral cortex is there, subcortical structures are there, and the brainstem and the spinal cord. So the cerebral cortex will plan and program any locomotion or any activity along with the concert of the subcortical structures like the cerebellum and the basal ganglia. And then these signals will be descending down along the spinal cord by two main descending pathways, which includes the ventral or the medial corticospinal tract, and we have the lateral corticospinal tract. It is said that this ventral corticospinal tract will be mainly controlling the proximal and the axial muscles. So that is also helping in the maintenance of the posture. Whereas the lateral corticospinal muscle tract is controlling the distal muscles, which are helping in the skilled movements. And as such, these lateral corticospinal tracts are supposed to be phylogenetically the newer one, whereas this is supposed to be an old one. The tract is an old one. So this is how it happens, and now we know it is an alpha motor neuron where finally the impulses will be going to the skeletal muscles or the voluntary muscles. So this becomes a final common pathway to all the muscles. And the regulation of the alpha motor neuron is important for the execution of any of this voluntary activity, because the signals will be coming down through the descending pathway, finally being delivered, or it reaches the skeletal muscle through the alpha motor neuron. So regulation of the alpha motor neuron is also important because it executes the activity. Followed. So when this activity is being done by the alpha motor neuron, we can see that there are peripheral impulses going from the periphery to especially this brainstem and spinal cord, because the brainstem and spinal cord forms the major relay station for the descending signals or the descending pathways. At the same time, this also acts as a main center where the integration of the maintenance of the posture as well as integration of the voluntary activity is being done. So this becomes a major center for the posture maintenance as well as integration of these activities. So what happens here is it also receives signals from the periphery. Signals from the periphery means whenever a person is doing some voluntary activity, the signals which are actually the mainly the proprioceptive signals regarding the length of the muscle, the tension in the muscle or the tendon, then the velocity of stretch of the muscle, etc. These are the proprioceptive impulses being sent to the third level here. So this is the first level, second level and third level. So when this is being sent, the intended act which has been decided and planned by the cerebral cortex is an intended plan, and the actual performance is there. These peripheral signals are helping to compare the intended act and the actual performance, so that there might be some errors. So if there are errors, that will be detected, and this errors will be detected and final correction will also be done. So we know the cerebellum is acting as an error detector, as well as a comparator. So it's comparing the actual intended act and the actual performance, because the signals, so it knows what the position at the periphery is, and the actual intended act comes, the instruction comes from the higher sender. So it will be compared, it will be after that detecting if there is some error, that error is detected, it is corrected, and the corrected signal goes again to the cerebral cortex, finally coming down to the alpha motor neuron, so that the activity will be performed. So there is an error detection and correction, and the final corrected signal comes to the, through the alpha motor neuron. So what happens? This performed act will be very much skillful and it will be very much coordinated. That's why the cerebellum has a role in coordination. So the skilled act is due to the alpha motor neuron through the lateral corticospinal tract followed. So this act, which becomes very much skillful and coordinated, is only because of this main brainstem and the spinal cord, which is acting as a relay center as well as a center for the postural maintenance and the integration of all these impulses, the, from the periphery as well as from the higher center, finally coming to the alpha motor neuron. So that is regarding the movement or the activity, where we have a three-tier system. So coming back again to the posture itself is maintained through different reflexes, which are integrated at different levels, right from the spinal cord, then it goes to the higher level, then again to the cerebral cortex, like that. Again, they are integrated, or there are several reflex mechanisms integrated at different levels, which will help us in maintaining the posture. So we know all these reflexes together will be integrated in an intact human being or animal, which all together fits into some voluntary activity. So the posture maintenance is because of the levels of integration of several types of reflexes, and finally this all together give rise to the person to maintain a posture as well as for an any activity. So when we consider movement, it is actually a transient change in the posture that results in movement. Otherwise, if you consider a man sitting quiet without any movement, there is no locomotion, no change in the posture. So if the person makes a slight change, what happens? There come the reflexes, which are actually acting as a dynamic phasic reflexes. Whereas when the person is sitting quiet, there comes a tonic reflexes. So we now see that whenever there is a change in the posture, that can add to the locomotion or even the other type of reflexes. Since these reflexes are integrated at different levels, they all together will be helping for the posture maintenance. So to know the different levels, we can experimentally make a transection at different levels and study the reflexes which are integrated at the different levels. So when it comes to the transection, there is a rule in neurology where whenever there is a transection at a particular level, the higher centers will always be having its influence on the lower centers. So once that level is cut, the level below the cut will now be released or taken away from the control of the higher centers. So what happens is, there is a disinhibition, or the inhibition coming from the higher centers will be taken away from the on the centers which are integrated at a lower level below the cut, and it usually gets attenuated or exaggerated. So this is what is happening, where the when there is a cut below the transected portion, this will be exaggerated because it is cut off from the control of the higher centers followed. And this is also explained not only because of the inhibition from the higher centers being taken away, it is also maybe explained, which textbook says further has to be found out the reason, where this is also being explained as part of denervation hypersensitivity, which we have already learned. So the exaggeration when there is a transection for the reflexes below the level of cut is due to denervation hypersensitivity. Because you can see in the spinal shock, where there is an exaggeration of the reflexes immediately following the spinal shock. That is probably because of this denervation hypersensitivity, as well as the inhibition from the higher center being taken away. So now, when we go to these postural reflexes, again, it is said that these reflexes are always under the control, where there is a redistribution of the muscle tone whenever a person changes a posture, or even when he is doing a voluntary activity. So the redistribution of the tone in the muscle will help us to maintain posture as well as do some voluntary activity. Because there are several groups of muscles involved depending upon the level of the integration of these reflexes, wherein we can see that there is this difference in the tone of the muscles. Even when a person is standing, the extensor group of the lower limbs will be having more tone than the upper limb muscles. So there is a difference in the tone of the muscles whenever a person adopts any posture. And this redistribution of the tone is brought about by a changing the excitability or a change in the threshold of either the alpha motor neuron, which directly supplies the muscle, or it is indirectly by changing the excitability or the threshold of the gamma motor neuron that is supplying the muscle through the muscle spindle, because that is a receptor. So the excitability or the threshold of the gamma motor neuron or the alpha motor neuron can be brought about in a fashion which is indirect or direct, so that the tone of the muscle can be altered, which in turn will help the person to maintain the posture, or even if it's a voluntary activity where which muscles has to be contracted, which all should be relaxed like that. So we now see that it is the change in the excitability of the gamma motor neuron or the alpha motor neuron that contributes to the redistribution of the tone of the different groups of muscles, which help in the maintenance of the posture or during voluntary activity. So now we'll see that to learn these levels of integration or the different reflexes altogether, which help in the maintenance of posture, we cannot attribute or discern a single reflex that helps in maintaining the posture. So these are present in all the levels of the spinal cord or the levels of the nervous system which help us to maintain the posture. So to understand these different levels of reflexes which help in the maintenance of posture, we have come to the conclusion by doing experiments on animals, and the animals which are usually used are the cat or dog or the monkey. So different types of animal preparations where transections have been done at different levels will prove the reflexes that help in the posture maintenance. So the animal preparation can be of the spinal animal, where this is having a lesion or transection is done at the level of the medulla. So we have the spinal animal. Next level of transection is the mid-collicular level, where it is actually in the lower part of the midbrain. To be more exactly, it is a mid-collicular section between the superior and the inferior colliculus. So this mid-collicular section gives rise to an animal which is called as decerebrate animal. Next is the animal which has been having a transection above the midbrain. So that gives rise to an animal which is called as a midbrain animal. Next is a thalamic animal, where the lesion is or the transection is done just above the thalamus. And finally, the animal where the cortex alone is removed gives rise to the animal which is a decorticate animal. So at these different levels, we could learn the reflexes that contribute for the posture maintenance. Is it clear? So having a transection at different levels of the nervous system, as I told before, the cardinal rule is the lower part will be released from the inhibition of the higher centers or the control of the higher centers, and they become exaggerated. So we could learn the reflexes at the different levels that are integrated, and finally all these are integrated together in a human being, in an intact human being or an animal, which helps in the maintenance of posture. So one reflex alone cannot be attributed or discerned to help in the maintenance of the posture. So these animals were actually sacrificed to learn the different reflexes at the different levels of the nervous system. Now first we'll come to the spinal animal, where the human being itself have the spinal shock followed by exaggerated reflexes, then the recovery of the reflexes, etc., which I have already learnt in the spinal, the transection of the spinal cord. So in the spinal animal, the reflexes which could be studied include a local static reflex, and the segmental reflex. So these two were studied in the spinal animal. So when it comes to the local static reflex, it includes the positive supporting reaction
And the other one is, along with this positive supporting reaction, we have a magnetic response or magnet response. Similarly, there is a negative supporting reaction.
What we see is, in the spinal animal, the four-legged animal, if we just stimulate the pad of the sole of the animal, it usually produces a rigidity of that particular limb, which becomes hyperextended. Followed. So, just stimulating the pad or sole of the feet of this four-legged animal, which is having a lesion at the level of the medulla, it usually produces an extension of that particular limb, which is called as a positive supporting reaction. At the same time, it may also follow the stimulus, which is called as a magnet response. But if the stretch is continued, made prolonged, that happens where the supporting reaction disappears. So that is a negative supporting reaction. So these reflexes could be studied in the spinal animal. Moreover, these are the local static reflexes. The additional reflex which have been studied in the spinal animal include the segmental reflex, which include all the reflexes, the simple reflexes at the spinal level, which can be the monosynaptic reflex, where we have the stretch reflex, isn't it? Then we have the inverse stretch reflex. We also have the crossed extensor reflex or the withdrawal reflex. So these all have been studied in the spinal animal. As you know, stretch reflex is a basic mechanism by which the posture is maintained, muscle contraction due to stretch of the muscle. So this is also helping in the maintenance of the posture. Coming to the inverse stretch reflex, also you have learned, it is also a protective phenomena. When we consider the crossed extensor reflex or the withdrawal reflex, it's very important, especially we have learned in a four-legged animal. It is also a protective reflex, wherein if we give a painful stimulus to one limb, for example, the right forelimb is stimulated by a painful stimulus, what is the response we see? Immediately, there will be an extension of the opposite forelimb. So the right forelimb is now flexed and the left forelimb will be extended. The diagonally opposite hind limb on the right side will be extended. Similarly, the diagonally opposite hind limb respective to the flexed limb will be also flexed. So when we consider the position of the animal at this stage, when it is stimulated by a painful stimulus, it is the posture adopted by the animal to protect itself. At the same time, it is also ready to run away from the painful stimulus. So that is what is happening when we give a painful stimulus to the four-legged animal. So these are all integrated at the level of the spinal cord. So all these reflexes we have already learnt along with the reflexes. So the withdrawal reflex especially is very important in a four-legged animal, where it can be studied also very well. So these are the reflexes which help in the maintenance of posture with respect to spinal animal, which we could study. Now coming to the decerebrate animal. The decerebrate animal, as I told you, it is at the level of the lower border of the midbrain. So here in the four-legged animal, when this lesion is done or the transection is done, it adopts a posture which is an exaggeration of the normal standing posture. Followed. So we see that this animal will be, suppose this is a cat, and it has an opisthotonous position where the leg will be hyperextended and the spine will be arched with the tail standing upright. So this is an opisthotonous position. So this is a normal caricature of the standing position, but it is exaggerated. And this is what is called as opisthotonus. Followed. So this is an opisthotonus seen in an animal with a decerebrate or a decerebrate animal, and the lesion is in the lower border of the midbrain. And we see there is hyperextension or rigidity of all the four limbs, where the animal will have an arched spine, tail also standing upright. So when we consider the human beings, they are two-legged animals. So what happens here? In such a person, the person will be lying down with hyperextension of all the limbs. Why? Because the flexors of the upper limb are anti-gravity muscles. they are also extended, as well as lower limbs will also be extended. But there is hyper extension or rigidity. So why does that rigidity come here? We'll explain later on, coming to the decerebrate rigidity. And the reflexes that has been learned here, where
so the animal that is produced by this transaction is a decerebrate animal with opisthotonous position, and the reflexes which have been studied here includes tonic neck reflexes and tonic labyrinthine reflexes.
Followed. So these were the reflexes which could be learned in a decerebrate animal. Now coming to the tonic neck reflexes which help the animal to maintain the posture includes, we will consider four aspects wherein this cat or dog or whatever it is made to dorsiflex the head. So here comes the role of the neck muscles that help in maintaining the posture. Suppose the head is dorsiflexed. What we see is, we can compare as if the animal is looking at a hole over a shelf. So the position of the limbs will be in such a way that forelimbs will be extended.
The forelimbs are extended, at the same time the hind limbs will be flexed.
So this is a position adopted when
this head is dorsiflexed.
So it is as if the animal is looking into a hole over a shelf or over an obstacle. So just imagine a cat looking into a hole over a shelf. So the position adopted will be extension of the forelimbs and flexion of the forelimb, hind limb. Extension of the forelimb, flexion of the hind limb. So that is one reflex which helps for the maintenance of posture, coming with the tonic neck reflexes. Another one is, this animal itself, if it is looking into a hole, here it becomes the opposite way. What happens?
There will be the flexion of the forelimb with extension of the hind limb. So the animal will be like this. It is looking into the hole where now the head is supposed to be ventroflexed. This is a dorsiflexion of the head.
Followed.
Whereas here it is a ventroflexion of the head.
Wherein that the animal is looking into a hole, there is a ventroflexion of the head which produces the opposite response to the previous one. So the forelimbs will be flexed and it is looking into the hole. At the same time, what happens is flexion of the forelimb and extension of the hind limb. Now let us say it is the lower part of the neck where we do the ventroflexion. So the ventroflexion which is made at the lower part of the neck, this will result as if the animal is crawling into the hole. So what happens as if it is crawling into the hole? All the limbs will be flexed.
So it is as if lying down and it is flexed. It is crawling into the hole. So it is completely flexed at the root of the neck.
So we are pushing the head downwards at the root of the neck, which itself can explain by the position adopted by the animal when it is crawling into the hole. So as it is crawling, all the limbs will be now flexed. So these all are examples for the tonic neck reflexes that help the animal to maintain the posture. In addition, we see something where if the head is rotated in one direction, let us say the head is rotated to the left side, immediately we see the forelimb on that side will be extended, and this is called as a jaw limb. So when the head is rotated to one side, that side forelimb will be extended. This is the jaw limb. If it is extended to the right limb, forelimb will be extended. So that is a jaw limb. So all these are in favor of the reflexes at this level which help in maintaining the posture. Is it clear?
Now coming to the tonic labyrinthine reflex, what we see is when the animal is made to lie in the supine position, it will exhibit a maximum rigidity of the limbs. Whereas if it is made to lie in the prone position, the rigidity will be minimum. And if it is made to lie in the lateral position, the rigidity will be midway between the prone and the
supine position. This is what we see, and this is actually due to the labyrinthine apparatus or the utricular and sacular maculae, which help with the maintenance of the posture. So this is just to see how it helps. The rigidity will be shifted with the position of the animal. So this is what we see. Now we will go to what is the decerebrate position or the opisthotonus in human being, as well as the positive and negative supporting reaction, which can be seen in an animal in a video, as well as how it appears in the case of a decerebrate animal or the human being. Now this is another example for the jaw limb as well as the body writing reflexes. Whenever the child is turned to one side, you can see when it is turned to the right side, you can see the extension of the limb. See, when it is turned to the right and the left, there is an extension of the right side or the left side. Accordingly, the limb also will be extended. But more than that, you can see the body writing reflexes here. When the child is turned to the right side, it will extend the right limb. And to the left side, it will extend the left limb. The body writing reflexes will also come to play because the body is stimulated from one side. This you can see, we learned about the tonic neck reflexes. This is the ventroflexion of the head. Immediately you can see the limbs get extended whenever the head is ventroflexed. Otherwise it remains flexed. Here you can see the jaw limb on this slide as well as this slide. Whenever there is a turning of the head to the right limb is also extended, the forelimb. Here when it is turned to the left, you can see the left limb is extended. Here it is similar to the animal looking over a shelf into a hole. So you can see the extension of the forelimb. And here when there is a ventroflexion, you can see the flexion of the forelimbs where the animal is looking into the hole. Here it is over an obstruction looking into the hole. Now coming to the decerebrate rigidity. We learnt about the decerebrate rigidity, which was brought about by the low lesion at the lower border of the midbrain. So when it comes to the decerebrate rigidity, we see that there is hyperextension and extreme rigidity of all the four limbs. The explanation for this decerebrate rigidity is that we know there is an influence from the higher level to the lower level of the nervous system. And we see that it is through the gamma motor neuron that the reticular formation, which will control the muscle tone. And the reticular formation also is of two types, where we have the pontine as well as the medullary reticular formation. And pontine is stimulatory in nature and this is inhibitory in nature, isn't it? So there is the influence from the cerebral cortex where there are inhibitory areas of the cerebral cortex, and there are facilitatory areas also, but mainly there are the inhibitory areas coming from the cerebral cortex. So the influence of the inhibition coming from the cerebral cortex is mainly through the area 4S, a strip which is called as a inhibitory area from the cerebral cortex. In addition, we have the basal ganglia as well as the cerebellum, all of which will be influencing through the reticular formation, producing an inhibition. And this acts through the gamma motor neuron. Is it clear? So the gamma motor neuron is inhibited by the influence of the reticular formation, which in turn is under the control of this inhibition coming from the cerebral cortex, 4S area, cerebellum and the basal ganglia. All are inhibitory areas or inhibitory signals coming down, and it regulates the gamma motor neuron. So when this inhibition is taken away, the net effect will be of facilitation, because this facilitatory area of the pons, the reticular formation, is always having a spontaneous discharge. So in addition, what happens is the peripheral signals coming from the, or the proprioceptive impulses coming from the periphery, are also continuously stimulating the facilitatory area. So what happens is the facilitatory area is stimulated from the periphery, it is taken away from the inhibition from the upper centers, so the net effect will be more of facilitation through the gamma motor neuron, and finally it results in a hyper extension or extreme rigidity. So that is what is explained for this decerebrate rigidity that happens at the lesion of the lower border of the midbrain. Is it clear? So this is how the decerebrate rigidity occurs, and this is supposed to be the classical Sherringtonian type of decerebrate rigidity. So the rigidity that happens by a transection at the level of the lower border of the midbrain results in a decerebrate rigidity which is acting through the gamma motor neuron. So this is called as gamma rigidity, whereas there is another type of decerebrate rigidity which can also be produced not by this neurological lesion but by ligating both the common carotids and the basilar arteries at the pondomedullary junction. So by ligating the carotids and also the basilar arteries at the pondomedullary junction, we produce an ischemic area which can also give rise to the decerebrate animal or the decerebrate rigidity. So this is an ischemic type of rigidity compared to the classical Sherringtonian type of rigidity due to transection. But here what happens is, since it produces an ischemic area, the anterior lobe of the cerebellum also gets affected. And this lobe of the cerebellum is concerned with the maintenance of the posture, proclonodular lobe. So the impulses coming from the lobe to the vestibular nucleus now gets affected. Is it clear? So we have the vestibulo-vestibular tract which we learned in the last class. So this tract will be affected and the vestibular nucleus will be discharging at a high rate. So what happens? That is coming directly to the alpha motor neuron. I told you in the beginning itself, it is a variability in the tone of the muscles or the redistribution of the tone which can be brought about directly to the alpha motor neuron or indirectly to the gamma motor neuron that discharges into the muscle spindle. So here, because there is a lesion in the cerebellum and because it indirectly affects, it also affects the vestibular nucleus which now spontaneously discharges or increases its discharge, that will come to the alpha motor neuron which in turn will now be responsible for the decerebrate rigidity. So this type of rigidity produced by an ischemia by the ligation of the basilar and the carotid arteries also produces a decerebrate rigidity, wherein this is now called as an alpha rigidity, not a gamma rigidity. Followed. So there are two types of decerebrate rigidity. Now this type of decerebrate rigidity produced by the neurological lesion can be got rid of or it can be abolished by drugs or by deafferentation, by cutting the dorsal root ganglia, or even drugs like certain procainamide and all will be producing an abolishing this decerebrate rigidity. At the same time, this alpha rigidity cannot be abolished. So that's the difference. So the method by which the alpha rigidity and the gamma rigidity produce is different. Also, the effect can be abolished in one type, but it cannot be abolished in the other type. Is it clear so far? So this is the decerebrate rigidity, and the reflexes which can be studied here is already been explained, includes the tonic neck reflexes and the tonic labyrinthine reflexes. Now when we come to the midbrain animal and the thalamic as well as the decorticate animal, we see that all the writing reflexes can be studied at the midbrain level as well as in the other level, where these writing reflexes help the person to maintain the posture by doing some writing mechanisms of the body and the head, whereby the destabilized person can be made stabilized to maintain the equilibrium. So here comes optical writing reflexes, body writing reflexes, and the neck writing reflexes. So all these can be hereafter learnt in these animals. So coming to the optical writing reflexes, which was already mentioned in the last class, there are four important impulses which help for the maintenance of the posture, of which one is vestibular, other one is visual cues, third one is a proprioceptive and the cutaneous. So this is very important for the human being, wherein a person who has lost his labyrinthine function and suppose he is having a sensory ataxia, the proprioceptive as well as cutaneous is gone. labyrinthine is also gone, that person can at least manage with the visual cues. So this becomes very important in the human being rather than in the animals. The next is the body writing reflexes, where whenever the body is stimulated on different parts, it will help to maintain the posterior reflexes, where the head will be correcting on the body, body will be correcting on the head, like that. So not going into the details. And this is again the neck writing reflexes, which already we have learned is also contributing here for the maintenance of the posture, because it will be head on the body, body on the head, neck on the body, like that. So all these are helping in the maintenance of the posture, which can be elicited in the animals here, these all these animals. But when it comes to the decorticate animal, where only the cortex is removed, so we have the decorticate animal wherein the posture adopted here will be in such a way that if it is a human being, the upper limbs will remain flexed and the lower limbs will be extended. So that is a decorticate position or the posture in a human being. So akin to this, in the human beings we can consider hemiplegia, where especially the commonest lesion of 60% of the lesions resulting due to lesion of the internal capsule secondary to hemorrhage or block. So that always results in the decorticate type of posture in a human beings. So the initial part we can see is a flexion of the upper limb and extension of the lower limb, isn't it? So decorticate in the human beings can be considered similar to that happening in the hemiplegia, because the rest of all the lesions will be contributing about 10% in the cerebellum lower and the other types or the pons, like that. So here 60% of the lesions of the hemiplegia secondary to the lesion of the artery that supplies the internal capsule results in a decorticate type of lesion in the human beings. Here it is manageable or it is compatible with life. But if it comes to the decerebrate type of lesion in human being, it is not possible, because here even the all other homeostatic functioning can be maintained because hypothalamus and other structures are preserved here. And why does the forelimb undergo flexion? What is the reason? Here it is said that the red nucleus is now at the higher level, so it produces a contraction of the flexion or the flexion of the forelimb or the upper limb muscles. Whereas in this type of lesion, the decerebrate, it comes below the level of the lesion. Red nucleus is below. So what happens? Here it results in a hyperextension. The control is gone or inhibition is taken away. So the appearance in the decorticate and the decerebrate are different, and compatible with life is the decorticate animal, not the decerebrate animal in the case of human beings. But here also we can learn certain reflexes which are integrated at the cortical level. Those are the placing and hopping reflexes. Now coming to the placing and the hopping. Suppose a four-legged animal is pushed to one side. Immediately the animal will step two or three times in the direction of the pushing or in the direction of being displaced, and then it comes back to its original position. This also happens in a human being. Accidentally, if one person is being pushed to one side, immediately one or two steps will be taken by that person and then he comes to the upright position. So that is called as a hopping reaction. Whereas coming to the placing, although it cannot be demonstrated in the human beings, it can be demonstrated in a four-legged animal, which also can be seen in the development of the infant reflexes, which finally they have it during the milestones of its development. So in the example for the placing reaction or the placing reflex, what we do is we just hold the animal and make it touch with its sole on top of a surface of a table. Immediately the animal finds its way to maintain the posture by touching that surface. Suppose we make it blindfold and then make the snout or the whiskers to touch a surface. Immediately the paws will come and it will find its way to maintain the posture. So that's a placing reaction, which is produced, or the reflex which is shown by a four-legged animal, just to demonstrate how the placing will be helping the animal to maintain the posture. This can also be shown in the video which will be shown now, where the small infant as it is made to touch a surface by its leg or even the hand, it will try to maintain that position by touching that surface. So many of the infant reflexes can also be learned here because, as I told you, phylogenetically it is a ventral pathway which is older. But as a child develops and the milestones are developing, all these reflexes are helping them to maintain the posture, and finally the person, as it completely develops the posture maintenance by the age of 2 and 3, what happens is the lateral spinothalamic tract also has been myelinated and the child will be able to stand upright without any support. But all these reflexes can be seen in the infants during the development of the milestones. So that can be seen in the next video, which will be shown. It is also shown these type of reactions in the animal as well as the other reflexes. We'll see it now. And also we'll just show a slide on which we can see the decerebrate posture of the human beings as well as the integration of all these reflexes, which in turn will help in the maintenance of the posture. See, this is a video showing the placing reaction where the child has not yet started to stop. So you can see whenever the child has the foot being placed, it tries to stand up. So this is an example for the infant reflex where we can learn the placing reaction. Now you can see the animal standing, and when it is being pressed, it can still remain in the same posture because of the tone in the four limbs. Because of the redistribution, it can maintain itself in the position. Here the tone is much reduced when it is made flexed artificially or by inducing that reflex. This is just to show the absence of the tone of the muscles when it is anesthetized. There is no tone for any of the muscles of the body. There is no tone, there is no correction of the head over the body or even by the limbs. Now this is a hopping reaction. As an animal is made to hop or push to one side, it is trying to maintain the balance by hopping in the direction where it is being moved. And here you can see both the visual as well as the placing reaction when it is made to touch a surface. Here it is not being touched, but it takes the help of the visual cues to place the limbs. This is a contact placing reaction where we can say it tries to place the limbs and maintain. And here the cat is made to fall, but it will always get corrected itself, the head on the body, by the labyrinthine reflexes. And the total time is shown only 1.5 seconds, within which time it gets corrected and stands on its four limbs. So here is the importance of the labyrinthine reflexes. However much we make it fall, it will come and stand on its four legs. And this is the diagram showing this is the decerebrate rigidity, whereas this is the decorticate rigidity. And this is the one showing the jaw limbs when it is turned to one side. You can see if it is to the right side, this is extended, and this is turned to the left side, left limb is extended. This will remain flexed. So here you can see in the decorticate rigidity where the upper limbs are remaining flexed and the lower limbs are hyperextended. Unlike the animals, which is four leg, our anti-gravity muscles are the flexors of the upper limb. So they remain flexed and they are not maintaining the position where it should be remaining, in the extended position, if it is maintaining a normal caricature or posture. That's why it is seen here as flexion. So in the decorticate, if it is on one side, we can see that the person will be having a flexed limb, upper limb on the side of lesion with extension, and an externally rotated limb in the case of hemiplegia, because that is an example for the decorticate rigidity in human beings. Whereas here, if it is a decerebrate, as I told you, very many homeostatic mechanisms are lost, and this is not compatible with life for the human being in decerebrate rigidity. This is the human beings again showing the decorticate rigidity, and another is a decerebrate rigidity. This is a decerebrate rigidity. You can see the hyperextension, but at the level of the wrist it can be slightly flexed. This is the overall principal posterior reflexes shown in the chart form. You can see the stretch reflexes, positive supporting, negative supporting, tonic labyrinthine, tonic nephrectomy, everything. So here at the spinal cord level is the negative and positive supporting reactions as well as the stretch reflexes. Coming down in the medulla, we can see the tonic labyrinthine and the tonic neck reflexes. We learnt in the lesion where it is below the midbrain. So here comes a midbrain animal, and after that it is a cortical level. So here is a placing and hopping reactions which is integrated at the cortical level. The optical writing reflexes are also at the cortical level, which is very important for the human beings, and the rest of it all are coming at the midbrain level. The labyrinthine writing, neck writing, body writing and body on body, all those will be integrated at the midbrain level. So that finishes posterior equilibrium.